Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created, and he established them forever and ever. He gave a decree and it shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures in all deeps, fire and hail, snow and mist, stormy wind fulfilling his word, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, beasts and all livestock, creeping things and flying birds, kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth. Young men and maidens together, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his saints, for the people of Israel who are near to him. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's why you've come today, and I thank you for being here. I'm so glad that you chose Oakleaf to praise your God. And we're going to do that this morning. We're going to get busy, if you hadn't already started, with your singing, praising God. And may God put a song in your heart and his praise on your lips. And may your mind be filled with the goodness of his glory and grace. And may your body be filled with his love, his action, as you walk through this world. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you to praise you this morning because you are good. We come to you to praise you this morning because you are great. We come, Father, because you sent us Jesus. Who are we, Father, that you're mindful of us? Who are we that you care for us enough to send your son? I can't stop praising you for that. And I pray, Lord, that you'll give us a spirit in this church that we can't stop praising you for the fact that Jesus came into the world, that salvation arrived with him. There's no greater thing. And you gave it to us, small and weak and sinners and unsure of ourselves and Lord, sometimes unsure of you, and yet still you gave him to us. We thank you, Father. And so we praise you. Amen. Good morning. Merry Christmas. I said Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Happy Dogs Beat Sooners Eve. Go Dogs. Go Dogs. Amen. Amen. We got any Sooner fans? Amen. Amen. If you have a youth and he or she is on the mission trip, happy Free at Last Sunday while they're gone up to Gatlinburg and you're all here all by yourself. My son went, took my coat because he lost his coat yesterday. I don't can't find my coat. And now I'm cold. But I got a house without him with my wife and my little boy. Happy day. I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to praise God with you. I'm glad that you've brought your gifts. I'm glad that you've brought your heart. I'm glad that you've brought your voice to sing the songs of God and to share your company with me. Thank you for being here. All of you, no matter who you are or where you're from. And I especially this day want to thank you if you're from the North, if you're a Yankee. We got any Yankees here? Raise your hand. I'm from the North. Anybody else? I'm from Johnson City, Tennessee, all the way up north. And you are too. There we go. Thank you for being here. You may have heard some grumblings from some southern old, crusty, curmudgeon, grumpy people. Might have grumbled from time to time that y'all have come down here and made the traffic a little bit worse. Not me. I'm glad you're here. It might be every now and then you might hear someone say, you know, changes the culture and changes the way we, and not me, y'all add to it and make it better. And I'm glad you're in the church, you make it better. Sometimes they're valid, but most of the time they're not. For example, I've got a 13-year-old boy and 11-year-old boy raised in Georgia, the deep south, the Bible Belt. And normally when we go to a restaurant, I say, water only, right? Because that's where they get you. That's where it costs. Water only. But every time we go, they always look at me and they ask, can we have a, get this, they ask, can we have a soda? Like they were born in New York City or something. I say, what? It's a Coke. And they say, what if we want something, another thing besides? And I say, it's a Coke. And it's because of you. But there are good things. There are good things. Great things. If you've been in the South for a long time, if you're raised here, particularly in past generations, you know this is true. It is bad luck, or it was before we started having a bunch of Northern people move down. It was bad luck to have your Christmas tree and your lights up to New Year's. Am I right about that? You've heard about that? More than bad luck, I think the true matter is people were afraid that it was against taste, that you had bad taste. You were of low breeding, you were of low stock. If you kept your lights up until New Year's, your neighbors would think this person is out of control and unorganized. It might leave them up till June. You might as well leave them up till June back in the old days down here, because if you left them up till New Year's, you'd already lost your reputation. And I'm glad y'all have come down there here and changed that. Now we can keep them up. And you may have put yours away. That's all right. But I'm keeping mine up as long as I can. Till the HOA writes me two or three letters, I'm going to keep them up. Maybe longer. There you go. Still got my pumpkins up from Halloween. Might as well keep my lights on. Back in those old days, before you good northern folks came down, it seemed as if, at least to this little boy, when I was a little boy, the folks went, as soon as it was done, let's get this down. We had a good time. Jesus was born. Yahoo! But it's time to move on. Let's roll up the lights. Let's put them in a box. Let's put tape on the box and write a Sharpie on it. Don't open up till December. Put it away in the attic. Put it down in the basement. We've got things to do, and we've got to get back to the old way of doing things. Yes, we celebrated. Yes, Jesus came into the world, and we're glad, but let's move on. And let's not let it define us. My mom, when she was a little girl, it's so bad down here, Santa Claus would bring the tree and all the lights, and she'd wake up on Christmas morning. It had not been decorated before, and there was all the stuff. And then on Christmas Day, her mom would pack it all up and put it away. Is Christmas over? Well, I guess the day on the calendar is. But the truth of the matter is, Christ did come into the world. God sent His Son into the world, gave us a son for us, for us. And with this Son, salvation has come into the world. With this Son, we have a chance to know who God is. With this Son, we might do righteousness and not evil in the world. With this Son, we might have life. Is it over? Did you enjoy the Christmas Eve, rocking Christmas Eve on Christmas Eve this year? Man, I had a good time at that. That was good stuff. Good music, a lot of fun, a lot of laughter, good singing. We got the Christmas Shoes song. Oh, I saw all y'all cry at the Christmas Shoes song. Good videos, And we heard the gospel story from Luke 2, right? The angels and the lights from heaven and the shepherds in the fields and running down to Bethlehem and looking in the stable and finding the manger where this little bitty baby had cloths wrapped around him, bound up in swaddling cloths and laid down in a manger. And this mama and a daddy without a place to stay because the inn is all full. And out of this small thing, out of this quiet, dark scene comes the salvation of God in the world. Comes newness and life in a way that's never been known, and it's never been extinguished since. Oh, it might be time to put away that tree over there and take these wreaths off the TV screens and move on in your life. But this gospel story continues, and this story of the Christ child continues, and we ought to worship Jesus. We ought to worship God as we hear it. And so, continuing in that same chapter from Luke, starting with the 22nd verse, if you've got a Bible, open it up to Luke 2, 22. If you don't, let us know. We'll get you one. You can keep it if you need it. From Luke 2, starting with the 22nd verse, listen now to the Word of God. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Can I stop there for a second? Just a quick little aside. I thought of this morning. We're a young church. Y'all are a good-looking church. I looked down out at y'all, and man, y'all are pretty. Y'all are pretty. You're welcome. You're welcome. We're not blessed with a bunch of old people here. And that's a shame. That's a shame. It is. If you've been a Christian for 10 years, I hope that your faith is stronger than it was 10 years ago. Because that's what the Holy Spirit does. He grows us in our faith. I hope if you've been a Christian for 20 years that you love more, are more merciful, know more of God's truth, see Jesus in more things that go on in your life. I hope that if you've been a Christian 30 years, you want to worship more, you want to give more, you want to praise Him more, because that's what the Holy Spirit does. And if you aren't growing, then maybe with some fear and trembling, you ought to look and see who you're really following. Simeon's an old man. And Simeon has been being led by the Spirit his whole life. And he can see things and know things that new Christians don't. And if you don't have some old Christians in your life, then go find one. You might learn something if you do. Anyway, there was a man in Jerusalem, his name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit to the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God, and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. Amen. I said we don't have a lot of age in this place, so some of y'all might not remember this. Have you seen Sanford and Son? You know Sanford and Son? Red Fox, Mr. Fred Sanford. I like that show. If you're too young to know him, ask somebody about him. It's a funny show. And when I read this passage, every time I read it, I think of Fred Sanford, because when he got excited, "I'm coming home, you know, Elizabeth, I'm on my way," that sort of thing, hold his chest, act like he's having a heart attack. And to me, that's what Simeon is doing. He sees the baby Jesus, he sees the Son of God, and because he has lived into a maturity with God, because he has loved God his whole lifetime, and he has given his heart to God, and the Spirit of God is rested upon him, he sees this child, which we've seen hundreds of children in that place. He sees this baby, and he grabs his chest, and he says, "Now I can depart in peace. I'm coming. Because I've seen with my own eyes your salvation, God, in this little bitty child. I've seen what you have prepared in front of everybody. A light for all the nations of the world and glory for your people Israel. I've seen it all now, and it's all I need to see. I'm ready to go. I can leave this place in peace because you've shown me salvation. You've shown me the Lord in this little bitty child, this little bitty baby. He's seen it all." There was this little family. Yeah, but we call it a big family. Mom and dad, and bunch of sons, 12 sons. Seems like a big old family. But they thought of themselves as a people, and they were the smallest of all peoples, man. They look out in the world, and they didn't account for anything. Just too small to even be noticed in a world full of big things with big people and big cities and big powers and big money. They didn't amount to much. Have you been there? Do you know how that feels, to seem small, to think that what you do and who you are and who your family and friends are, well, we don't amount to much. It doesn't count if we're here or not. But they knew God, and God knew them, and it made all the difference in the world. And sometimes they were good because God loved them, and sometimes they didn't follow God, and they did wicked things. And do you know what that's like? To know God and want to do right, but sometimes, well, you want to do your own thing instead, and you want to do wrong. And because of pride and because of jealousy, they sold a son who was favored, who seemed like he was going places. They sold him into slavery. Have you ever suffered because folks were jealous? Have you ever suffered because of pride? Have you been hurt when family has turned against you? Or maybe you've been the jealous one. Maybe you've looked at those in favor and you said, "I want that. Why can't I have that?" Have you been there? And they sold this son into slavery, and they wanted to do evil. They intended it for evil, but God used what they intended for evil for good. And he raised up that slave son to become the ruler of Egypt, to govern in the name of Pharaoh. And when famine came, this wise slave had stored up grain for the kingdom. And when famine came, his family that had turned away from him, they came and they found this son that they didn't even know was alive, and they were saved. Do you know what it's like to have everything fall apart? To be hungry in your soul, to feel like all is lost, and God saves. He provides when it seems like there is no hope. And they came down to Egypt, and they grew fat, and they grew wealthy, and they grew large in number to where the Egyptians were afraid of them, to where the Pharaohs were concerned that they were in their land, and so they enslaved them. Do you know what it's like to lose? To have, and then have it be gone. And they cried out to their God, and their God, because He loved them, their God, because He never had forgotten them, had always been with them, had always kept His promises, He answered, and He sent a deliverer. He sent Moses, and by His own mighty hand, by the power and might, signs and miracles of God, He sent His people free. Out of Egypt and through the waters, and they walked on dry ground, and they went into the wilderness, and there in that barren place, they were still provided for. Do you know what it's like to have nothing and yet move on? Because God still blesses you when it seems like we've got nothing. Quail fell from the sky and manna came on the ground, sweet honey cakes to eat, and water flowed from the rocks, and their clothes didn't wear out, and their shoes were still comfy as they walked all around. And then they gave Him the law so that they might know who He is, so that they might understand what the will of God is, so that they might live godly lives and thus experience the joy and peace of God, so that they might live well. He gave them the law. And they celebrated it, and they tried to follow it, and sometimes they did, and sometimes they didn't. Do you know what that's like? They tried, and they failed, and they tried again, and they failed, and sometimes they got it a little right, and then sometimes they get it a little wrong, and they never were at one with God, and still God cared for them. Brought them into promise. Have you ever been blessed? Brought them into the promised land. Have you ever known the joy of having things? Gave them vineyards they didn't plant and cities they didn't build. Gave them a wonderful land. And they said, it's time to take the lights off the tree. It's time to pack it all away. We've had this good time with God. We've enjoyed all this wonderful celebration of coming into the promised land. Now we want things to go back to normal. Now we want everything to be like it is in other countries. We want a man for a king. We don't want you, God. You've been there. You stopped celebrating. God gave him a king. And then He gave him a man after His own heart for a king. And they grew mighty. And then He gave him the wisest man who ever lived as a king. And they grew mightier still. But still the people of God turned away from Him. And even those rulers who had been so favored by God turned away from Him. Have you ever been let down by your leaders? By your mom or your dad? By the people who teach you? By your employer? By your government? Have you ever known what it's like to trust, to need somebody, and have them turn away or fall down in the job? And civil war came. And the Assyrians came. And the Babylonians came. And they were carted off into slavery again. The temple was destroyed. When all seemed hopeless. Have you been hopeless, church? When all seemed dark, God showed up again and called the scattered people home, and they built up the temple again. They started over. Have you started over? They started over. But still good kings came and bad kings came, and all in all, and all, they couldn't follow the law. And then there were the Romans, the worst of them all, the greatest empire of them all, had them at their mercy, setting up evil kings before them, desecrations in the temple, and in this sorry place, in this troubled land, in this place where it seemed like the trouble would never end. An old man named Simeon and an old woman named Anna, they saw a baby and they held him up and they said, here he is. Here's salvation. Here's the Lord. Brothers and sisters, God's promises are sure and God's promises are true. He's faithful. Keep the lights up, man. Keep celebrating. Because once you've believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have known God and He has saved your soul and all is new. There might be trouble. Look at Israel. Trouble after trouble. There might be sin. Look at Israel. Sin after sin. And God is faithful. And because of Jesus, we know we've won the victory. What does Paul say to the church in Galatia? Galatians 4. Starting with the fourth verse, he says, but when the fullness of time had come, when all that needed to happen had come to pass, when God knew that it was the best time to bring salvation into the world, that's when He did it. At the optimum time. When we don't understand these things, but God does. And in the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, than an heir through God. Amen. Jesus had it all. You understand? He's God the Son. Eternally begotten of the Father. Full of glory and majesty. The King of kings and the Lord of lords. Sits by His Father at the throne of heaven. Nothing exists except which comes through Him. Through Him, and all things are made for Him. He's the Lord. Glorious and majestic beyond measure. But before time began, before creation was made, the Father said He will redeem His creation at His appointed time through God the Son. And at that appointed time, Jesus, God the Son, willfully and gladfully, and gladfully is that a word? Gladly and obediently, came into the world, and He came just like you and I did, through the dark, through the wet, through the cramp, into the light. Eyes couldn't open. If He saw the light, it'd burn His eyes. This King of glory, who did not think equality with God was something to be grasped, but emptied Himself, taking the form of a slave, right? This God of glory, this God the Son, He came into the world, and He breathed His first breaths in tiny baby lungs. And He couldn't hold up His head, and He couldn't feed Himself, and He needed someone to change His diaper, because that's how we came into the world, and He wants to identify with us. You understand? This Jesus, this God, our King. And he came into this world in that way, in our way, so that we could identify with Him and therefore know God. And He learned how to hold His head up, and He learned how to sit, and He learned how to roll over, and He learned how to crawl, and then walk, and then speak, and He learned how to read, and He learned how to be obedient because we could not be obedient. He learned how to be righteous because we have not been righteous. He learned how to love because so often we do not love, and he did the things that God wants us to do, and He did them all for you and me. He came into this world to preach good news to the poor, because we are poor. He came to give sight to the blind, because we can't see. He came to make the lepers cleansed, because we're dirty from sin. He came to make the lame walk and leap for joy, because, oh, how we need to run to God. He came to do the things that we could not. And He came for us. He came and He preached and He taught and He healed. And oh, how He loved. His Christ child came and He grew and He had favor. And he went to a cross and He died our death. And then He was raised by his Father's hand, by His Father's power. He defeated the grave, He conquered sin and death, and he was raised into life so that we might have His life. He took our death and He gave us His life. And we ought not take the lights down. We've had failure time and time again. We've turned away from God time and time again. We've been broken. We've failed to be an obedient church. We've not done God's will. We've not loved our neighbor. We've not heard the cry of the needy. We've not done all the things that God has called us to do time and time again. And we've tried. And yet still after all this failure, still after all this sin, still we can turn to God because Jesus has come into the world and say, Abba, Father. We are no longer slaves under punishment. We are the very sons and daughters of God. Keep the lights on. My wife had a car wreck this week. Wasn't her fault. She's a good driver. She had a car wreck, though. And it was a bad one. Tore up the car. And if the box truck that hit her had been 12 inches more to the right, it could have been bad. It could have hurt somebody. And my wife was in the car, and Tommy, my son, was in the car, and Jimmy, my son, was in the car, and he's a 13-year-old. He's always got his friend with him the whole time. Always, you know how that is. Carter was with him, and I love when Carter's around, which is always. I love when he's around because when they're playing outside, I can run out there and say, Jimmy Carter! You know, and all my neighbors lock the doors because they think there's a Democrat in the neighborhood. And they're like, there's a Democrat. And they're all in the car. And Midnight, the Wonder Dog, is in the car. And it got smashed. And I love that car. That's a good car. My wife loved that. That's her favorite car she's ever had. And it's gone. And the box truck driver's insurance company, they're not helping. They're just, well, we'll see, you know. We'll get you a rental car before January 9th, 9th, 9th. And it doesn't matter. I don't care. Because Christine and Tommy and Midnight, the Wonder Dog, and Jimmy Carter are healthy. They didn't get a hair disturbed on their head. You're going to have loss and you're going to lose. And there's going to be trouble. 2018 is going to be a great year. And there's going to be trouble. You're going to lose position and status at some point in your life. You're going to lose power or faculty of mind or faculty of body. You're going to sin, and you're going to be knocked down by sin sometimes where you want to stop. You hope you can live a better life, and you keep on falling. You don't know what to do. And I want you to know that He lives. That He is born. Praise Him, O ye heavens, right? Praise Him, sun and moon and all the stars throughout all the time of history. The twinkling lights of heaven have never stopped shining and praising God, never stopped celebrating that God is God. And though you may wrap up the lights on your house and take them off your tree and throw that tree away or put it in your attic, though you may box away your manger scenes and all the ornaments, wrap them carefully one by one and say, see you in December. You keep praising Him. If the sun and the moon and the stars can praise Him without voices, how much more can you with your voices? If the hills and mountains can praise Him even though they cannot move, how much more can you? If the cedars and the fruit trees can praise Him, even though they can't think, how much more than you? Keep the lights on in your heart. Because here He is. Here's salvation. A son has been given to us. And now you're a son. And now you're a daughter of the living God. Amen. Let's pray. Band's going to come up. We're going to pray. Lord, you sent your son, Jesus. You made him our Christ, our Lord. He proved your love towards us. So we praise your name, and we ask that you make us strong and wise and loving so we can keep on praising your name no matter the time of year. In Christ's name, amen.